Welcome to Community Involvement. This is a show that we do outside of Veterans View Show, and today we will be talking about Malali graduates. We have people here that's a Malali alum who's from almost every class, and today we're going to be talking about the history of Malali High School, which is now Malali Elementary and Malali Intermediate School. So we have some great history here. We have some people who have went far in their life, and that just goes to show you how good the education was that you got out of high school and went on to college. So we're going to start off here with Miss Kathy Epps, who's sitting next to me, who's a county commissioner. What year did you graduate from Malali?
1958.
Mm-hmm. And what all did they have at the school when you was going there?
The school was very limited to what we had, but what we had, we used it to our advantage. For an example, we did not have inside plumbing. During the time that I was there, we did not have a football game. We did not have a band. We didn't have anything, but the one thing that we did have was love for each other. We supported each other. We did not have a lab, but we learned how to athlete to fall and all that kind of stuff that we had to do. During those days, the students themselves went to school to learn, to obey, and to be obedient to the teachers. And plus the parents at that time, during those times, was very involved with the school. PTA was very important to our parents. So yes, the school at that time was very limited, but we have had great people to come from that school with the limited of tools that they had to work with during that time.
Okay, and we're going to be jumping around, so we won't stay on one individual person. But the next person I want to talk to is Ms. Crawford. Now, Ms. Crawford, Malali was the first black school in Fort Mitchell, correct?
That's right.
So tell us from your standpoint, when you went to school at Malali.
Well, I spent 2 years at South Shore, and then went to school over. I moved back home because I was bullying somebody.
Okay.
And all I tell, just like I tell my children, whatever the teacher put before you, you get it. You get what they put before you.
Do you remember the year that you started at Malali?
I don't exactly remember it, but I graduated in 1974.
1954.
1954.
Okay. From
Mighty Tiger. That's right. And I did well with what I got from Mighty, because I went there to try to learn.
Mm-hmm.
And I did real well, I think. I went to graduated there. Then I went to Columbus Tech for a while.
Mm-hmm.
And I was in a neighborhood grocery store for 20 years.
Oh yeah, I remember that.
And when my first two children was in college, I told my husband, I said, I'm going to get me another job. I said, because I don't want my children big and or nothing. I had one at Auburn and I had one in Alabama.
Mm-hmm.
And I went to work to help them. And I always told my children, I said, y'all, get what they put before you. Because when we were moving there, a lot of people didn't let their children come to Malali. They used to tell them, even in my family, they wouldn't let them come. But I went.
But why was that? Do you know why they wouldn't let them come?
I don't know, but they didn't let them come.
Okay. Well, so they was going to other schools, South Girard? Oliver?
Spencer. And different schools. They sent to different schools.
Okay.
They lost them, but I went, and all my children went there. And I think they've done well. They went to my graduation from my other.
Okay.
And on to my son, when he graduated from he had the star behind his name.
He had what now?
With the star behind his name.
Okay, he graduated with an honor band. Okay. All right.
He's now and reach out come.
Mm-hmm.
He worked in the Pentagon for 21 years, and he owned his own company.
Oh, that's
so
great.
So that's what Mount Holly put out.
That's what Mount Holly put out. Well, we're going to have to get with him and borrow some money, huh? What you think? Now, I'm going to flick it over to my co-host and tell us your name.
Sharon Alexander.
And Sharon, you graduated from Mount Holly as well.
Yes.
What year did you graduate?
1981.
So you one of the youngest ones, didn't
yes.
you? So I'm going to let you go with some questions and...
I just wanted to ask everyone here if they had any knowledge or information about the history of Mount Olive School, where it began and how it began.
One thing, the present Mount Olive is now, there was a wooden school. I didn't attend, but other people went across the street from where that school sits now.
Yeah.
And at that time, it was only... I want to say to the sixth grade, from what old language that I have, can remember, there was first and second was together, third and fourth were together, and fifth and sixth were together, but it started across from where it moved together. I'm a part of the one where it moved across, and a portion of it is there now. And as a lot of them have already said, there was good relationship, a lot of love, that was in that school at that particular time. And one thing that I can remember that Mount Olive did that it even helped in college, they might not have had public speaking, but they had something called the oratorical speaking, and that trained us how to get in front of people and talk. And also, we have choir. And we sing.
Oh, yeah. We had some people coming out there.
Now, of course, it started as a wooden school across from where the present school is located now.
And I want to say the Alexanders have a rich tradition of producing school teachers. They have a big family of school teachers, and that's a great thing.
Yes, sir, 55.
Class of 55.
Yes, sir.
Tell me something about 55.
Well, in 55, I left South Leroy, went to Mala.
Mm-hmm.
And we didn't have sitting children. We sit on the cement blocks.
Cement blocks, yes, sir.
Cement blocks. They could drive around South Leroy and everything. I didn't have no inside bathroom, had outside bathroom.
Mm-hmm.
And we played pretty good basketball. And you know what?
Yes, sir.
We put that line down for that basketball, and the good law come out and make with it. You know?
Yes, sir.
And that was what it was. We played out there, and it's TE time. I'm going to tell you what we did.
Yes, sir.
We got a pretty good. You know what men's and ladies, you know what a tip is on.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
And a shiver, go out there and pay. Instead of putting that, we dig in a hole, digging up those stumps out there in the pit. And where the field is now.
Yes, sir.
I know about it. Hello. I've been there.
Yes, sir. I know you was a good ball player.
Oh, absolutely.
Yes, sir. I used to come and go with it.
Come and go with it.
Hey.
You know, they made a song.
After I retired from the finished school and everything, I got on the softball team.
I know you played some baseball, too.
I woke up until they stopped. The Red Sox, we used to play baseball.
That's right.
And know what they do? We started with the baseball. You know what happened? Them fellas had guys on behind the field catching the ball. We sometimes couldn't finish the game. I could tell you, I could stay all day, but I don't know. I don't want to be too long.
But we're glad you're saying that, because we want the people to understand that back in the day, it was called a Negro school.
Yeah.
It wasn't called a Black school. It was called a Negro school. And we got a lot of hand-me-down books with pages tore out of them and everything. But the good thing about it was we had teachers who could teach.
Yeah.
And they was your cousins, so if you messed up, you got a whooping right there, and then you got a whooping when you got home, because if they wasn't your cousin, they was in the same church you was in. So your parents were going to get it. And Mr. Johnson, who was one of the principals,
yeah.
Mr. Johnson be sitting on your porch in the evening when you get home. And you know you was in trouble. You got in trouble at school. I got off the bus one day. Mr. Johnson was sitting on the porch, drinking the glass ice water. I knew it was over then. It was over then. But we're going to move back. Go ahead, Ms. F. You want to say something?
As well, as we grow, and during, when I was there during the period of 1958 and before, and some years probably afterward, we did not have a gymnasium. We did not have inside, we did not have a gymnasium. And the connection to the school and the church was that everything that we had at the school that could not be done in the school, in a classroom or on the playground, we went to the Mount Olive Baptist Church. So the school was very connected to the church. In 1958, I got my diploma from Mount Olive Baptist Church. We marched down the aisle. So history is great. There's a lot of history in the area. It has grown, yes, tremendously. It has changed tremendously. But even before the younger generation came along, this 1950s classes set the stage and for the next generation to come to build on what we have. So that is where we are now. We're still building on the shoulders of those first beginning schools in 1951 and on.
Okay, now I want to move to the back row and talk to Ms. Clara. Mm-hmm. Ms. Clara, tell us something about your experience in Mount Olive.
Well, I was fortunate enough to graduate in the class of 1965.
1965.
And by then, I was like one of the babies of the family, and all my siblings had gone before me. But I guess in addition to what everybody has said, some of it I don't remember happening, but I was in the first band. I was in the first, when they organized the band.
Were you a major at?
I was a clarinet player.
A clarinet.
And I was good. I played clarinet. And I can remember the principal at the time was William Morris. Mm-hmm. And we called him Prop Morris. But you know, he taught stuff that now I can really appreciate. When we first got a chance to go out and perform in a parade, mm-hmm. we had to have everything exactly right. Mm-hmm. He wanted those shoes that were white. Those mm-hmm. we called them our band shoes. But the sole had to be dyed black. And everybody was in order. The first thing that we performed in that I can remember, I think it was the Christmas parade. And everybody thought we were Florida A&M.
Sure. Rain and know it.
Everybody thought so. But that was one thing that sticks with me now. He insisted that when we got on that field, or on the street or wherever, we were dressed
to impress.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. We went to parades in Montgomery. We went to parades in Tuskegee. We were in the Christmas parade and start here and go down Broad in Columbus. Mm-hmm. And people remembered us.
Mm-hmm. Y'all set an example for the rest of us who came behind.
It was just not the band, it was the choir.
Yeah.
The choir went out. They had to have on their white dresses. Mm-hmm. Those young men had to have on their white shirts, black pants, and they were in uniform. Mm-hmm. And if you wore jewelry, it had to be something small. You didn't want dangling. He just was
straight.
But we had a band director, Herbert Nicholson, who was not too much older than we were at the time. And he kept us in order.
Okay.
He kept us going, and he knew what to do for us, and he knew what we could do, and he knew the best ones or the ones that were not so good. Probably don't remember. Oliver Hunter was a, what you call it, a tuba player. And I never seen anybody could walk and play it like he could.
All right.
But he really did. He did.
Okay.
And but we learned theory too. You know, we were taught by good teachers like Mr. Herman Stevens.
Yeah. Yes.
Viola Jackson.
That's right.
And people who cared for us. And the teachers at the time, I don't know how they are now, but the teachers at the time, they cared about us learning. You know, they cared, they just to teach it in the classroom. When they took us places, field trips, they insisted that we conduct ourselves accordingly. I can remember Sammy Lee Van. She was one of the teachers, Katie Mitchell,
right.
And all those, you know, they were caring teachers. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And at the time we thought they were mean properly. Mm-hmm. But that's what they did, you know, and that's what we learned. And I think that we learned it to the extent of we made sure that our children got some of the training that we got. They got it from them, but, you know, through us.
Okay, great. We're here at the Community View Show. We're going to take a small station break, and then we'll be back with the alumni from Mott Island High School.
With the change of month, there came October. And now on New of autumn, we shared feeling. It was such a glorious autumn dream, yes it was. But like kids, we were too shy to say to each other that together we would always lie.
Welcome back to Community View. We're here with the Mott Island alumni from Mott Island High School, which is now Mott Island Intermediate and Mott Island Elementary School. And we're going to let Miss Alexander ask some more group questions at this point. Miss Alexander?
It's great to listen to everyone's stories. Mm-hmm. And believe it or not, some of us may have the same experience. But in doing the research for the school, I know the very first school that was the second school, mm-hmm. the very first building built in the 1950s, it was one building. But in that building was there's supposed to have been a library, a science lab. Do any of you remember if there were cafeterias, auditoriums, or what existed in the school, and how many buildings were there when you went to school?
I went there. It was just that one first building.
Yes.
And it had the principal office there and a classroom right across the typing. We did not have a science lab, but the science teacher did what they could as far as introducing us to those things. Mm-hmm. As far as a library, one of the classrooms had a little side place over there where they had a few sets of encyclopedias, but they was very much utilized. Mm-hmm. And as someone have already said, we did not have a bathroom. on the inside. We did not have a cafeteria, but they had a little area where they would cook something like hot dogs or things like that. We ate outside in our classroom. That was our cafeteria. Mm-hmm. And we enjoyed it. That's why we had many.
And also, while I was there, talking about a cafeteria, that was my cafeteria. But the thing that we learned to do is that the teacher, and I believe at this point, I think Ms. Mary Broom was there. She was like the English teacher and also our economic development teacher. We had what we called 4-H, and the 4-H instructors and directors would come to the school and set up and show you how to cook, teach the students how to cook, and things that we learned, like making yeast bread, how, you know, to do these type things. But then we were there to learn. So we paid attention to what was really going on in that classroom as we learned. Because then too, your parents was 100% behind you. If you was disobedient, you didn't want to get disciplined at school. You got to, and I don't know how mama knew what was going on, but before we got home, they knew exactly what had happened in school. They didn't have cell phones. So I'm just wondering how they found out.
They talk with drums.
Add to that 4-H club. We also had the 4-H club, somebody come in and start us with, learn how to the carols and everything. Mm-hmm. So I still kind of hang with that. I don't go too far from it now.
Okay.
And they come there and teach you how to handle cows and everything, and that helped us a little bit. You know, we did all that.
Make sure your garden was right and everything.
Yeah, they got to go out right. I'm still chopping some now on the porch there. I run the garden because the deals are so bad now.
Mm-hmm.
Until you have to buy I put it. When I water the flowers, I water the garden. Goodbye.
All right, Miss Zane.
Well, I want to hear from some of the younger audience.
I know. I'm sorry, go ahead, O.D., please.
My name is Oliver Davis. I'm a graduate, 1972 graduate of Mount Olive High School. And I first attended there, I guess, in the 1960-61, my first grade year. Mm-hmm. During that period of time, there was only one building that I'm aware of. Mm-hmm. And our source of heating was a big pot stove inside the building.
Mm-hmm. I know what you're talking about.
And one of the joy for us during the day was that only a certain group of guys would be able to go into the woods to get wood. Yeah. To bring back in for the fire to keep heat during the heating, during the cold time of the year. And so we always enjoyed that. It was like a second recess for us, for those guys who got opportunities to go.
Get away.
Yeah. And the other part of it is that the teachers that we had there was all professional. They taught us to have a high level professionalism, how to carry ourselves, how to speak, how to dress yourself, neatness, speak when you're spoken to. And they had a way of showing us how to be disciplined. And when that strap came out and you did something wrong, you know that you were going to get disciplined well. And that's something that you didn't want to do, get caught up in that. And then once you got that whooping again, like other people said, you were going to get a whooping at home too. You think he whooped you, wait till you get home. You're going to get the other one. So discipline was very well used during that time, which is opposite of what the elders don't have nowadays. And you see what the results are there with our young kids today. But the utmost thing was that we had to get an education.
Amen.
And we knew the books that we had were outdated. Mm-hmm. We had to make use of what we had with those books that we did have.
Mm-hmm.
Pages were torn, some were speared up, but we still managed to be able to survive and learn from those things that we did. With the great effort by all the teachers and the administrators, like Mr. Morris, Mr. Johnson, and you taught Miss Jackson, who taught us English, Coach Ingersoll, Coach Isom,
right.
All those guys brought in another level of professional level with them, because we started establishing ourselves as one of the dominant athletic teams in the area.
Right.
During my 3 years that I played basketball, baseball, and football, we only had probably about in my senior class, we only had 23 boys. So if you played football, you were going to play basketball. If you played basketball, you was going to play baseball.
Right.
Only one or two guys may not play at all three. But from that chemistry that we established during that period of time, we were one of the schools that, we were one of the class that during our senior year, we had the undefeated football season.
Mm-hmm.
From that class, we had five guys to go off and be professional athletes. Mm-hmm. Four in football, right, and a basketball. I was one of the ones that was fortunate enough to be able to have a good, successful football career in the NFL, playing with the Cleveland Browns and the Cincinnati Bengals. Mm-hmm. Played in two Super Bowls. Mm-hmm. And so all that began from the foundation that I established back at Milo High School.
Mm-hmm. Well, let me ask you this, Oliver.
Yes, sir.
You know, because I was in school at Mile Island when you was playing football, and I was a little fella, and I used to come to the football game. I came to one because I couldn't come to a whole lot because I lived so far down in the country.
Yeah.
I came to one of the games, and the band came out there at halftime, and they really rocked it up here in Phoenix City Stadium.
Hello.
They made the other school look bad. I mean, they did what they had to do. Then the football team came out, and Clarence Jones, you know, remember Clarence used to run that Statue of Liberty.
Yeah.
I tell you, Mott Island had some of the greatest, and I used to love it when Mott Island and South Gerard played. And that was the game of the year. That was just like going to the championship game. I mean, so, but the other thing I wanted to say, and we talked about our teachers and how they taught us and everything, is that if you didn't play sports, anything, you can look for Viola Jackson to try to get you a scholarship or academic. In some kind of way, she was going to try to get you in school. And they didn't play, like I say, you didn't want Prop to whoop you. Now, if you did something wrong, Prop had a piece of a wagon strap that he hit you with.
Mr. Morris.
You did not want Mr. Morris to whoop you. He's gonna do you good.
Right. So, I'm gonna say this too also, excuse me, mm-hmm. But I also was a part of the class that was involved in the transition of integration. My junior year, when they actually put in forced integration, where those kids who live below Knuckles Road, mm-hmm. was supposed to go to my high school. I was one of those group. I was one of those family, mm-hmm. and everybody else was supposed to go to my. I did not want to leave Mile Island, mm-hmm. so I found some kind of way to arrange so I go to Mile Island instead of going to Shabal. So we drove every day back and forth to school. It was about four or five of us.
And see, you was fortunate because I was forced to go to Shabal.
But then
I came back to Mile Island. I moved in with my aunt who lived in Mile Island, mm-hmm. subdivision, mm-hmm. and I was able to come back. And then when they found out that I was on the basketball team at Mile Island, they made a complaint, so then I couldn't even be on the basketball team.
Right.
But I was still at Mile Island where, mm-hmm. I wanted to be.
Yeah.
And so now we want to hear from some of our younger people who are came after me. I came in 75, 79.
Yeah.
Talk to
Frankie Horace, I came out in 1979. Unfortunately, a lot of people don't agree with us, but that is the class. Class of 1979 is considered to be the class. But anyway, with that being said, listening to some of the other people talk and speak about the great times and things that happened in Mount Island, two things that I take from it is the dedication that we had and the principles that was given to us from our faculties and what took place there, it actually took us to another level to what we was able to accomplish. I'll never forget this. When I played for Coach Ingersoll, Oliver and I did, he told us that there'll be three things that take place after hearing Ms. Epps, Ms. Crawford, and Mr. Kelly, some of those talk about what they did in their time and that was there. He said, we were always looked apart, beat apart, and played apart. So that took and made a whole nutshell of everything that we was about when we was at Mount Island. I was a part of the first class, first team in 1978 to actually go to the state playoff and to win two games there and was a game away from playing for the state championship. That was class of 1978, very good baseball. And it really hurt me when I came up in the 76, when Coach Eisen left Mount Island to go to Kendrick. It hurt me so bad. I cried because I wanted him to teach me baseball. But just because of his principles and what he had in him, I wanted it to be a part of me. It's just like what everybody else is saying. What Ms. Jackson had, what Mr. Morris had, what Coach Eisen had, and those people, you wanted them to invest in you so you can be that person and actually move out and become phenomenon of what you did. Because mm-hmm. Mount Olive had that, and they did. Oh, another thing too was that took place was we had parades. Mm-hmm. And the parade that we had actually started at
in the sun.
It started at Mount Olive Church. They would stop the traffic. We came down Mount Olive Church. We marched through, and then we would come through the sub. Mm-hmm. And you would see parents that would actually come out of their house and actually indulge, dance, and just have a good time. When that orange and green came through, people want to know, who is that? And we're very proud of about heritage at Mount Olive. It meant a lot.
And I want to say this, and then we're going to get to Mr. McCoy, let him tell us some of his history. But we all know what life coaches are, right?
Yes.
What they do. Well, all of our teachers at Mount Olive was not just teaching you from a book, but there was life coaching
Absolutely.
You as well.
Absolutely.
They talked to you about personal hygiene. They talked to you about sexual transmitted diseases. Yeah. They prepared you for
Absolutely.
Life.
Did.
They did not just stay in that book all the time. So
right.
I give the credit to those because they prepared me. I joined the Navy when I retired, and I was ready for it. And because of those teachers and the things that they did. And if you got in a fight, if you messed around and thought you were going to get away and you got in a fight, they would form a circle. Y'all remember that?
Yeah.
Put the boxing gloves on both of y'all.
Let's go.
Y'all got in that circle, and y'all had to box it out, and then it was over after
that.
It wasn't no more. The best man won. Now, I don't know what they did with the girls, because they didn't put no girls in no boxing ring. But we didn't have girls getting into much trouble like that anyway. So, but that was some time. So, Mr. McCoy, tell us something about your experience with Mount Olive High School.
I've been listening to the rest of my schoolmates talk about their experience in Mount Olive High School. And in 1956, when I left Macedonia Elementary School, going to the big school, six rooms.
That's right.
In Chicago, they held sixth grade.
Mm-hmm.
It was, I think the thing about it I remember most is that it wasn't a school so much, it was a big family.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes.
From teachers, although there was so many McCoy and Jane went there, but there was a big family. You knew everyone.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone took care of you.
Mm-hmm.
You took care of everyone else.
Mm-hmm.
The teachers took care of you. If you got a problem with a teacher, you didn't have a problem with a teacher, you had a problem at home.
Mm-hmm.
That's right.
But it would get back home.
Mm-hmm.
I literally went from the cotton field to the baseball field, I mean football field. Went to the cotton field, football field. When I first went to Mars, I didn't know a thing about football. You didn't have TV. I didn't know a thing about football. I listened to Oliver talk, and I got to know Oliver later on. You know, I got there and not very athletic. I could plow, I could do the whole thing. And they formed the first football team. Mr. Johnson, Mr. Howe. And you formed a football team with kids who didn't know a thing about football. Although some of my schoolmate will dispute this, but also, I think I ran the first touchdown at Mount Olive. The play was a 33 slant.
Guess who?
R.R. Morgan up in Central Alabama.
Yeah. What was the name of the game? R.R. Morgan.
So the Apple Oliver came after me. I made Oliver what he is. And I said Oliver the Super Bowl.
There you got it.
But you know,
on shoulders.
But then I look back, not only me. When I say, you know, I left Mount Olive at the Florida school, and I'm a lot of things that my schoolmates talk about, the band, all that came after me. Mm-hmm. Cadillac, we didn't have the band. She saw the band come along. I didn't see the band because I was in Florida. But when I came back from Florida, retired and came back, and we had our first reunion. Mm-hmm. In 2006.
Yes.
During that reunion, I realized how great Mount Olive High School was.
Absolutely.
The number of students,
yes,
that were there showed up from all over the United States.
Mm-hmm.
And the number of students, they were at the reunion and not in jail.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
How many successful students? How many students Mount Olive put out?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Not just a few, many.
That's right.
And they left their footprint. They're still leaving their footprint.
Mm-hmm.
And I went to Florida, came back. I went into education and for 30 years. But I think I was successful in that because the foundation that I was laid for me at the Mount Olive.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You talk about whipping. I mean, I had probably the best around.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I didn't want, because I would take mine at school because I didn't want to get home.
That right. That's right.
I didn't miss school. Because if I missed school, I knew if I didn't want to in school, I was behind the mule.
Well, tell us about the mule, because you made a statement that you couldn't wait to go to college. You was going to get your lesson in school for you could go to college, get out behind that mule. Tell us about that.
One of my biggest thing in the classroom when I had a class, I used to tell my students about my typical day in the field. Up at 5:30, plow the mule. You plow the 7. Your brother will bring you lunch. You plow the 12. You have an hour for lunch. You go back, plow until 8:30. Get off, put the mule up, and then you go to get ready for bed, eat, and all that kind of stuff. And the kids in my classroom were sitting up thinking, five, 6, 7, 8, 9. They were counting the number of hours that you plow the mule during the day. And he said, of course, he said, that's over to almost 12 hours a day. I said, yes, from 5:30 to 7, from 6:30 to 8:30 was the best time of day to plow the mule. And it was teaching, it taught me work ethic.
That's right.
You know, I didn't know it. It's just something that you did, something you had to do, and you did every day.
Mm-hmm.
And I promised myself, if you just let me get from behind this mule, and I'm going to school, go to college, I would never worry about watching the rear end of the mule again. But you know, that's it. Thank you. Mom, we were the best.
Yes.
The class of 62.
Mm.
Countless class of 50.
Eight.
We were the 24 students in my classroom. In my class.
Well, and you know, as we get ready to close, and after I finish, I'm gonna let Miss Alexander ask one more question. But as we close, I want to go around and started with Miss Alexander on the back row. tell us how many people was in your class, what college did you go to, and then I want to get to Oliver, because I want to ask Oliver, because I know when Oliver graduated, and I used to listen to Mr. Ingersoll and the other coaches, and they used to tell those college recruiters when they come in there, you can't get this boy unless you take a girl too. So you got to give a girl a scholarship in order to get our athlete. So we'll start with Miss Alexander.
Anna Alexander Lindsay, I am a proud graduate of the class of 1961, which was the class at Mount Olive High School. There was 22 students in that class. And I can say that over half of those students attended college. I am a proud graduate of Alabama State.
All right,
Alabama State.
The Golden Hunters.
And it was Alabama State University. And I came back to Phoenix City and worked 30 plus years. But one thing I would like to say that I haven't heard anything about the teachers during that time. There was one teacher, he was a football coach, Mr. Howard.
Yeah.
Wilson Howard was instrumental, and he looked among the students, and that may not have been scholarships during that time, but there was an educational organization called Pickett and Hatch, and he made sure those students that he felt could go on and pursue further, he persuaded and motivated and even helped us to get a loan from Pickett and Hatch. Education and foundation.
Right.
But that was a good experience. Mount Olive, I got a good learning experience because the teachers cared.
And from Alabama State, you got your degree in education. And you taught here in Phoenix City.
In Phoenix City.
For how many years?
30 plus years.
And still teaching.
And still out there working.
Teaching at church and everywhere else she can. So she never stopped.
So and from Alabama State, I got my BS, but from Georgia State, I got my master's. And from Troy State, I got
the 6 years. Well, congratulations. We appreciate it. Oliver, tell us about your college and...
I'm a proud graduate of the 1972 best model class. In which that we had a class of 43 in the classroom graduating. 23 was boys on a good day. And I attended Tennessee State University on a football scholarship with several other guys, and I was the one guy that got thrown into the package. So that's how we rolled. So coach said, "You gonna take them? You gotta take them all." And so that's how I ended up at Tennessee State. And we had one guy to Coach Clarence Jones went to Memphis State.
Yeah.
At that time, but they wanted all five of us to go to the same university, but he wanted to play basketball, and that was the best option for him to play basketball, which he had an illustrious career playing basketball at Memphis State University. From there, all four of us that went to Tennessee State, two of them left and went to Southern, and he went to Southern, did well there. He had the opportunity to end up playing in the National Football League with the Philadelphia Eagles, and that was his name was Johnny Jackson. Yeah. His brother stayed at Tennessee State with me, along with Otis Lewis and myself. And we all graduated from Tennessee State with a degree. And Nathaniel Jackson played running back for the Buffalo Bills. And, of course, I ended up playing with the Cleveland Browns for a number of years. From that, we just also received a degree. And I came back home to share my experience and my education experience and skills with the within the city in my neighborhood, hometown. So I taught in the school system for 27 years and now retired and enjoying life. Every day is a great day for me.
now, didn't Otis play for Detroit or somebody?
Homer. Came a year after us.
Okay, Homer.
We came back and got Homer.
Okay.
So we knew we had several more athletes, great athletes back at Mile High School. We recruited several more. A couple of them to stay, but Homer came in and stayed and had a great career with the Detroit Lions.
Yes.
Outstanding offensive lineman.
Okay.
So he did, we all did very well from the experience and the education that we received from our high school, from our teachers and coaches.
So the classes keep growing. And you notice the classes keep growing.
Well.
We're going to do one more, and then we're going to get ready to close it out.
Okay.
Okay, Clara?
Yes, my name is Clara James. I just happen to marry O. Jackson.
Okay.
I'm a James by birth. I was in the best class anyway, 1965.
That's when Mr. Hurst got something started.
That's when Stevie Wonder was singing. But it was only 29 of us in that class.
Going down.
I attended Tuskegee Institute. Mm-hmm. I don't know how many went other places, but some of us did. Some of us went in the military. I do know a couple that went in the military. Yeah. But I went on to work at Fort Benning for the Department of the Army. For 40 years, I worked at Fort Benning. And I'm proud of it.
Mm-hmm. We're proud of you,
it's
too.
The government was good to me. Okay. Still is.
That's what I was going to say.
Still is. And I raised two wonderful children. One of them went to Auburn University. Now he's the Dean of Financial Affairs at CBCC. That's my son. My daughter is a marketing executive for Deloitte, and she lives in Atlanta, Georgia. Mm-hmm. Don't have to raise any grandchildren. And I'm just living life of Riley.
Mm-hmm. All right, thank you.
Are they Jacksons or Jamies?
They're
Jacksons.
Okay.
They are Jacksons. I
want to
say one thing.
It looks like everybody want to say something. We'll make it quick.
Now, I didn't go off to college, but I did Sturdy's. Mm-hmm. And I retired in the finance on the computers.
On the computer, you could have bought it from way back.
The night that the first bull dropped in the rack, I was sitting at the computer.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Okay. You didn't push that button, did you?
I retired on it. You know, I went for the government.
Yes, ma'am.
And that's where I went to.
Okay, great.
Hello. Say, this man right here, Oliver Davis. Y'all see that man there? I played baseball. He played baseball with me before he went to play with Cleveland. Yeah. And every Sunday, that TV would come on, Oliver with the Cleveland in. Cleveland. I was there. I go in the number and everything. I be following around, you know. Mm-hmm. I played baseball. And then I went into softball. I played with Detroit. We played with Detroit. He started playing softball in Florida. And he pushed it that thing and that, but it's still working now. Hello.
Okay.
I'm doing that.
Oh, yes, sir. Okay, Miss Epps.
Yes. I think this is a great discussion that we are having, and maybe we need to get together and just have a roundtable discussion with the Mount Island alumni. Just talk about what we're doing. But I would like to say when I was there in 1958, out of this whole class, it was only 18 of us. Mm-hmm. And in 58, out of those 18 students, I believe it was four that I can remember that went off to school at that time. And that was George Alexander, Mary McCoy, Elizabeth William Morris, and
Bernice Stephen,
yes. Mm-hmm. And I can remember those four that went off to college. For myself, I got married and had a family of two. Thank you, Lord. But after I got married and had my children, I did go to Phillips Business College in Columbus and completed my career of 2 years in business administration. And in 2000, I was elected as the first Black female to serve as a county commissioner here in Mercer County, Alabama. Mm-hmm. And because of that election, I have had the opportunity to finish 120 plus hours with county government through the Auburn University Extension Center. And it all stemmed from not only school. It stemmed from teachers mm-hmm. like Miss Chappelle. You all don't remember Miss Chappelle. That was before your time. Miss mm-hmm. Annie Cox. You don't remember Miss Annie Cox.
Yes.
Miss
yes.
Cox. Who? Miss Annie Cox. Miss Sarah Fagans was there. Miss Annie Fitzpatrick was one of our teachers. And Mary Boone. Also, Ms. Eddie Mahone was one of the teachers there during that time. Ms. Bessie Pippins and Ms. Annie Ross. When I got to Mount Holly, Mr. Morris was the principal, I believe. I think Mr. Lewis was going out. Mr. Morris was coming in. And another one of my teachers was Mr. Alfonso Johnson, who taught chemistry, and I was scared of frogs.
Yes,
I had to deal with that frog without being in a lab. So he taught us all of this. And the basic thing that you all were standing on our shoulders, because 1958, we had the first yearbook that came out. Mm-hmm. Oh, we were smart students.
Okay, we're going to move on now.
Thank you for the opportunity of this roundtable discussion. And there's so much more that we're going, expand on.
Okay, thank you. You're welcome.
All right, Frankie Hart is class of 79. Again, we had a deck of cards, 52. Graduated in our class, 52. Left Mount Holly, went to Alabama State on a baseball scholarship. Majored in marketing, didn't get the degree, but it was a great experience when I took the principals from Mount Holly and it went along with me. I was able to work as an operator in the carbon black industry and moved and made some strides and so forth. I also served as president of school board in the Phoenix City school system, which was a great thing for me. I learned a lot, learned how to talk to people and respect. It's just what we did. You remember the cliche, it takes a village to raise a child. That was what Mount Olive did for all of us. We all helped raise everybody. And it was a great time. Everybody participated. Everybody wanted to see everybody do well. Everybody knew about Oliver. Everybody knew about Vance. They knew about them all. Even when you, Mr. Davis, when you left, and the thing that I think I remember was that you were there at the president protecting him on one of your tours.
That was in the presidential support.
I remember that.
Mr. Mays went to the Secret Service, and I went to the Ceremony of God.
That was the thing that made us so unique, being such a small community school that actually supported each other. Thank you.
We supported the country. I mean, if you look at everything that you've done, look at yourself. Miss Alexander, we ain't heard nothing from you.
Come on. Yeah.
Well, first of all, I want to say I graduated in 1981.
Yeah.
But it's great to sit here and listen to all of you all because the common thread, no matter whether you graduated in 1950 or in 1981, Mount Olive had a standard of excellence.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
And whether we didn't have a cafeteria the best books or whatever, we were taught how to accomplish even with that the best of what you had.
Yes.
There was the support of the community and the support of the family. That is what made Mount Olive so strong. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to just say this and I'll end on that. I remember my senior year, I was competing for an award before Russell County Board of Education. And at that time, they had begun the discussions of consolidating the schools in mm-hmm. Russell County. Mm-hmm. And I was asked the question, how did I feel about that? And I told them, I thought that would not be beneficial for the students in Russell County, because one of the things that was so helpful with the three different schools there was that there was specialized individual care for the students. Mm-hmm. We took pride in that, and I felt that was what helped to encourage us to be successful in what we wanted to do. Now, that was not met
I can believe it.
Yeah. That was not met with any good comments. In fact, I was told how wrong I was. But I know for a fact that having that community school with that community pride, with those expectations, is what helps us to excel and to be the best at what we are all doing now. And I hate that it has ended.
Well, you know, that speaks good to where you were at that point in your life with the education that those teachers had given you to give an answer to them.
That's right.
At that manner.
Yes.
So that shows what you was being taught, and you was already being trained on critical thinking. So I want to say, first of all, I'm a 1975 graduate of Mount Olive High School, and we had the largest class of 66 seniors. We had 66 to graduate. Mostly all of us went somewhere and done something, whether they went to college, military, whatever. My choice was to go in the military. Mm-hmm. And I served 21 years in the world's greatest Navy, served aboard 3 aircraft carriers and 1 guided missile frigate, and went basically around the world. But I want to close with this. I want to give a shout out to Josephine Ford.
Yes.
Who worked with Mr. McCoy as far as setting up these class reunions and things and all of the other things that we've done and she's currently doing as far as this marker that we're going to be putting out, the historical marker, to remind everybody that Mount Olive was a high school. And not only was it a high school, it was a great high school.
Yes,
and the other thing, when is the date for the marker laying? 16th of July.
Yes.
6 o'clock in the afternoon. Bring your food, because it's going to be a short class reunion.
Yes.
And don't leave before you help clean up if you make a mess, okay? Because we are very proud of what we have accomplished, and all those things, we don't want to leave the school with a bad rep.
That's right.
Also, Josephine has a play coming up. She's a playwright.
Yes,
so we want to give a shout out, because she has a play coming up in August, I believe, or September. August the 6th. So tickets are on sale at Mel and Abe Barbershop. So go on by there and get you one for $20.
Okay.
If you don't want to pay $20 and you want to be more supportive, wait till the day of and pay $25. But it's going to be at CVCC, Chattahoochee Valley Community College. Okay. So this is going to be a great play. I've been to her plays. Yes. They are super. So come out and support her and what she is doing. We have some pens that are... Josephine was ahead of getting some of that well.
That's right.
If you want a pen, you can buy a pen, put it on your clothes when you come out to the, when we put the historical marker down, there will be plenty of people there. We're going to have most of everybody who's anybody as far as elected officials there. So come out and give your support for your school.
Hello.
And if you still cook good barbecue and chicken, make sure you bring it on out there too.
Right.
So, in closing, we thank you all for being here on the Community Improvement Show, and we'll see you next time down at Mile Island, was high school, but now his elementary and intermediate. Thank you all. See you next time.